Hey guys, Alan here. A couple weeks ago on one of the forums, I wrote a post about a theory for what I would call the advanced workflow. And this is removing all of the islands that Flame is. So Flame currently has its own frame stores. For the most part, people run with their own frame stores, which means its own clip library on every machine and its own set of users on every machine. This is kind of convoluted, wasteful on resources, and I think it can be done better. So I had a theory about this advanced workflow where everything's centralized. You have a central frame store, central clip library, central user repository. Some of this is sort of doable now. You could put frame stores on a central NAS or SAN, but that still results in clip libraries and users being separate. So I had this idea to basically take a machine and make it what I'm going to call a dedicated Stone and Wire server. I've done that, and I want to show you kind of how that works first, and then I'll explain it in a little bit more technical detail after, because it's really boring if I sit here for 5 minutes talking to this static screen. So first I'll just show you on my workstation, my Flame workstation, which is Google. It's a Z820, and I just have a GPU in there, and network card. I have no internal SSD arrays at all. And I'll just show you that real quick. That's just an OS drive. It's just 250 gig SSD drive. And if I issue an SWDF, you'll see it literally says no partitions exist on this file system. So I'm gonna switch to TeamViewer and I'm gonna launch Flame. And I'll show you how this could be used. I'm still kind of in the testing phase, but we have a project starting up imminently, and I'm gonna just put it right into production and give it a shot. So here is my Flame, Ghoul, and it's a Z20. So normally you would start it like this, local file system or local host. And you'll notice that the new button is grayed out because there's literally not a StoneFS partition or StoneWire partition configured on this machine. The whole point is we're using a remote frame store, and it's a dedicated one. So I'm going to choose Monster, which is what I'm calling the frame store server or StoneWire server. And I'm just going to create a new project and call that test01. And I'm going to make that a Sony F55. I'm going to switch that to 16-bit. And I'm gonna give it a generic user group, and we're gonna create that. It takes maybe 10 to 20 seconds longer to create the project this way than normal, but I'm okay with it. I think the benefits well outweigh that additional 10 or 20 seconds. And now to get the centralized user repository, instead of using list from localhost, we're doing remote host, and I am just going to create a user here called Alan Test and create that user. Okay, so now let's launch into our Flame. And it's behaving as normal, you can see, which is great. That's what's expected. I have dual monitors, so you can't see my library view over here. But actually, I think I could just do this. First, I want to set this to protect from editing. All right, so I'm just going to create a colored source right now, and I'll make it, now let's make it 800 frames. Okay, now obviously that takes no compute power and no disk space, so we need to, just for the sake of this test, I really want to show processing and rendering and working with footage in this manner. So I'm going to do a burn-in metadata just to create some unique frames on disk. And I'm gonna just do a little matchbox grain just to add another little thing to the mix and crank that up so we can really see it. Okay, so I'm gonna render this, and I am gonna switch to the system monitor. Okay, so now you can see that it's rendering in the background, but feels pretty speedy, and it's sending it over to the remote frame store varying at varying speeds. but I'd say averaging maybe 1.4, 1.5 gigs a second. There's spikes much higher, the spikes a little lower, so on an average. Now, if I add on some of our machines, we have 16 SSDs in a hardware RAID, and that gets about 6 gigs a second reading. Slower writing, but to be honest, I don't know how much slower, if it's 2 gigs or 4 gigs. I don't know. It's never been an issue, but in working this way, in this advanced workflow, I haven't seen any slowdowns. And again, I only have 8 SSDs. I don't have 16 like in our other machines. And as you could see, I could scrub this. TeamViewer is not updating very well at all in this real-time manner, but it scrubs and it plays in real time, just as you would with a local array. And when I'm playing back, I'm getting like 2.5, 2.7 gigs a second receiving from the network, so off of this Stone and Wire server. So in a singular environment, this isn't really all that interesting. It's more of a technical demonstration. The whole point is in a multi-user, multi-flame environment. So to show you that, I'm just gonna quit out of here real quick. And I am gonna switch to another machine, which I have already loaded here, Zombie. And now I'm gonna be controlling this remotely. I'm not sitting down at that machine as I was Ghoul, but to show you how this works. So this is Zombie inherently, and then if I switch to Monster, right, you could see that test one project we made, and I could also go to remote host and my user is there. So again, this is everything centralized. I could choose to create a new workspace or to enter the workspace in which I was working on Ghoul. So let's see what happens. Okay, so you see my clip is there. TeamViewer is not doing such a good job of updating, but you can see I could play and scrub that clip and do whatever I want. It's as if it was a local frame store. So this is really interesting. Some things I haven't yet fully explored is the round tripping between Lustre, but this all seems to be working fine. I don't anticipate any problems with that. So this opens up some really interesting workflows, space efficiencies, creating user profile efficiencies. It's just quite an interesting way to do it, I think. And again, one of the big reasons was to centralize everything. So normally on a flame, if I did something like that, I would have under clip library. Yeah, see, I don't even have a clip library because on Ghoul, I don't have a local stone. So there's not even a clip library to have to look at. Normally, you would have a separate clip library on every machine. You'd have separate user profiles on every machine, and you'd have separate redundant data on every machine. So if I was on Ghoul and I copied a clip from Zombie, it would be duplicating that data over on another frame store. So you're consolidating everything. You're making the usage of your premium SSD space much more efficient. You're simplifying clip library storage, and you're drastically simplifying your user profiles. I know some of you make crazy amounts of hotkeys and have complained over and over again that user profiles are not transmutable between versions and machines. So this doesn't get around the version problem, but it definitely gets around the machine problem. Okay, so I hope you can see from that portion of the demonstration the workflow possibilities there, and I hope you understand it. I think it's gonna be really cool. I'm gonna move forward with it. I'll go over briefly the technical aspects of what I did to make this happen. I won't go totally into depth, but just give you a brief overview. It's not that bad. And maybe I'll post step-by-step instructions if people really care. I don't know. Maybe this is all just my own nerding effort. Okay, so to achieve this, I really wanted to run on the Stone and Wire server the most minimal amount of software and services possible to make this happen. So that means I don't want to have a full GUI install of the OS. I don't want to have to run the DKU. I don't want to have to install Flame. I really want just the most minimal amount of stuff, software and services. One, for complexity issues. Two, reduced memory overhead. And three, reduced CPU or processing overhead. So the basis of what I did is CentOS 7.4 minimal OS install. So this has no GUI environment, it's text only. It has very few system services and ancillary software installed. It's literally basically just enough to get the machine up and running, give you a command prompt. And it can probably run in 100 megs of RAM. I have, I think, 164 megs of RAM installed in this machine. And then I put that towards ZFS and its file caching, which makes it really efficient as a file server. Okay, so I start off with CentOS 7.4 minimal. I went 7.4 because it's the latest version of CentOS, so it has the latest drivers and other softwares. I just believe in staying current. I really am frustrated with the way in which Autodesk drags ass and continually is about 2 years or more behind on their OSs. Okay, so we have CentOS 7.4 minimal. Now the next challenge was to get the Stone and Wire server and hopefully only the Stone and Wire server installed and not have to install a great deal of ancillary Flame packages. So I was able to do that. It took a little bit of testing and trial and error, but less trial and error than kind of method. So I was able to figure it out, and it's all working. So I got a very clean Stone and Wire install. You can see here, there's no Flame packages. There's no Flame packages, a bunch of other stuff that I just didn't install. But the Stone and Wire portion is just working fine. I'll just show you that if we go into SW, we do an SWDF. We have, you know, it's working perfect, fine. There's a partition there. It's working. If I wanted to do, for instance, a IOPerf test, that works. I'm not going to let it finish, but I can tell you it's, I'll just let it finish in the background. I get about around three gigs a second, sometimes a little bit more, sometimes a little bit less, depending on just the runtime. I'll just let that go in the background, and maybe I'll show you the results of that later. I don't know. So we have this very minimal CentOS 7.4 install on Monster, which is Z800 with 8 SSDs in a ZFS array, and we have a very minimal Stone and Wire server install. Then on my test client, my test Flame workstation, again, it's a Z620 actually, and I have a P6000 installed on there, and I have one 10 gig network card and one 50 gig network card. The network in Monster is a 100 gig network card. So I have on Ghoul, which is my workstation, no SSDs in there for a frame store. I only have a small SSD OS drive. I'll show you that right now. It's a 250 gig OS drive, very plain vanilla install, of Autodesk's version of CentOS. One thing I did change is because we have a variety of network cards that we're using in the facility, and currently I have two network cards installed. As I'm validating, I have a 10 gig network card for our main production network, and I have the 50 gig network card in there for this test network. Autodesk made a really poor decision when they migrated it to CentOS 7 in using the classic Ethernet naming scheme, which in certain situations, and unfortunately in ours, can lead to port swapping. So the different cards will take the assignments of different network names randomly without really much control or pattern to them. It's really frustrating, and it was a really poor decision on Autodesk's part. So I did change the way in which the network namings are happening, and I changed them to the modern scheme, which is called persistent network naming. So you'll see they have funny names. Doesn't matter what the name is, but I can guarantee you, no matter what I do to this machine, no matter how much software I install, if I change the ports of the network cards or the PCI slots of the network cards, if I mess with the kernel, these names aren't changing. They're always going to be the same for a given network card, which makes it much easier to deal with. So outside of that, this is a very vanilla install. I just don't have any internal SSD arrays, and I've not created any stone and wire partitions. So if we do an SWDF, you'll see that literally no partitions exist on this system. So it's completely 100% using the remote stone and wire server, and multiple machines can use that, and multiple machines can even use that for the same project. And so I think it's going to make it really much easier from a system administrative standpoint, but also a collaborative workflow standpoint. The other way in which this is beneficial, several ways overall, so I'll recap them and I'd say we have a centralized data dump. So data is only in one place. It's not being copied between multiple machines redundantly. Centralized clip library, centralized user repository, but also it's going to make archiving a lot easier. You know, right now, if you had four machines working on a project and you had to archive that project, you'd have to go to four machines and archive from each of those machines. Now I just have to archive the project from one machine. So I think that's also really good. So there it is. I mean, I don't know if you guys think it's cool, but I do, and it's something I want to explore some more as we put it into production and validate the robustness of this solution. Thank you.